part two of our message series we're calling My Big Fat Mouth. Are you excited? Don't you like calling your mouth big and fat? That's great, isn't it, right? Now, this is important, though. We talked about this. If you missed part one, we talked about this. Why is this so important? Why are we spending some time in the month of August in this conversation about our mouth and about our words and about our tongue? Because the reality is that your life has been shaped by words. Like, literally, the way that you see yourself, the way that you experience the world around you. I mean, literally, what you saw this morning in the mirror, when you looked in the mirror to get ready, hopefully you looked in the mirror, but when you looked in the mirror, what you saw was shaped by the words that have been spoken to you and over you and about you. And so what have words done to you? Who spoke the words that shaped your life? I mean, I've heard so many stories. I look around this room, right? What have words done to you? For some of you, words have crushed you. Right? They've destroyed you. They've belittled you. They've crushed your esteem. They've created doubts. They've crushed your dreams, right? Words that were spoken to you. Or for some of you, right, words have given you courage. Like you faced obstacles or you faced challenges. You went after things that you didn't really think you could do it on your own, but because somebody spoke words of life and encouragement to you, you went after, right? So words have shaped your life. Your life has been shaped by words. You know, as I was preparing for this the last few weeks, I was reminded of a message I received not long ago from a student that I used to have that was part of our church in Chicago. And she was a student. She was like 11, 12, 13 years old. And she sent me this message. And here's what it said. It said, "Hey, Greg, I was actually just reflecting a few weeks ago on some encouragement you gave me about creativity." Way back when. She's like 25 now, so way back when, right? Way back when, right? Way back then, and how it was formative for me in those years. And now she's like 25, 26, and she's working at this creative agency in downtown Chicago. And there were words that were spoken to her as an 11-year-old, as a 12-year-old, that shaped the trajectory of her life. And the reality is words, right, to you and to me, as I've reflected, there's been words that have crushed me and discouraged me and belittled me, and there's been words that have given me courage to do things I never dreamed I could do. And this conversation is so important because words, these little things you can't see that are flying out of my mouth right now, these things are powerful. They're powerful. They're so powerful, and you're powerful because your words are powerful. You have enormous power because you have the ability to speak. And if you think about it, our words have destructive power. In fact, I would say they have more destructive power than any other parts of our body. They're the most powerful thing that we have. In fact, you can destroy someone. This is how powerful your words are. You can destroy someone without even being in the same room that they're in. That's how powerful words are. You know, in fact, if you don't believe me, this is how powerful words are. I could actually ruin my career today. I could stand up here and say something, and I could literally ruin whatever good that I've done the past few years. It could all just be ruined immediately, right? I could say something, and you'd roll in here next week, and there'd be a guy standing here, the chairman of our board, the chairman of our leader. He'd be standing here, and he goes, "You guys remember Greg?" Yeah, yeah. Good guy. He said he was sorry, but he won't be back. Right? He won't be back, right? I remember I have a friend who he has this golf group, right? You know, these guys that get together every week and they play golf. And so he has this golf group and they get together. And so this group of four guys, they got together and they play golf like every week. And this happened for years, right? I've known these guys for years. And like not just years, like decades, like 20 years. Like just playing golf every week, we get together. And over time, this little golf group got competitive. And it got competitive, and they start getting into it, you know, and it gets probably a little too competitive. And I don't know what happened. Again, I've only heard kind of the story third hand. But at one point in this 20 years, something was said. There were words that were exchanged, and now they won't even talk to each other. I mean, 20 years, like decades of families hanging out, taking trips together. I mean, these guys would vacation together with their family. 20 years. All because of something that was said, gone, destroyed. And now they won't even be in the same room together. See, words are powerful, right? Words are powerful. You know, last week we talked about this guy named James. And if you were here, you remember I talked about this idea that James was the brother of Jesus. Now, right? So Mary, Joseph, and he's like the younger brother of Jesus. Why can't you be more like your brother? Yeah, right, okay, thank you. And so he grew up, right, around Jesus. And James did not believe in Jesus. He didn't believe all the stuff that Jesus was trying to sell. He was like, nope, I'm not into that. And in fact, we conclude from history that James thought his brother was crazy. And then something happened. His brother died on a cross, and he was there, and he saw Jesus hanging on a cross, and he's probably thinking, well, they finally got him for being crazy. But then 3 days later, Jesus comes back to life, and he appears to James. He appears to James, and they have a conversation. They have breakfast together, and all of a sudden, James goes from not believing to believing. And so James now becomes a follower of Jesus. He says, my brother is the Messiah. My brother is the Son of God. My brother is my Savior. You think about that for a second, right? What would it take for you to say your brother's your Savior? Nothing, right? Right? So here he is. He becomes a leader in the church, and literally about 30 years after Jesus dies and is resurrected, James gets murdered. He gets killed for his belief in Jesus. But James was this really wise man. His nickname is kind of what he was known for at that time was James the Just. And he was very wise. And he wrote extensively to the church. And he wrote a lot about words. And he had this enormous insight, this enormous wisdom when it comes to the idea of words and the power of words. In fact, you could say it this way. My greatest relational regrets might have been avoided if we would just read and apply the simple principles and teaching of James. And think of, these are free too, guys. Like, his writings are free. They're everywhere. I got them on an app, right? If you would just read and apply these simple principles that James teaches about the power, you don't even have to be a Jesus person. If you would just read these, your future regrets could be avoided. And so here's what he said last week. If you were here for part one, we read this. It was in James 1. Again, he's writing to the church, and he just say, hey, listen up, guys. He says, hey, brothers and sisters, take notes. Sit up straight. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. You should listen to this. He said, hey, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, right? Quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. And what he was saying, if you were here for part one, he said, hey, relationally, when it comes to your relationships, you need to just make listening your top priority. Like, make listening the first thing you do, and then when it comes to speaking, what that slow to speak literally means, it means wait and be late. Like, be late in your speaking. Like, slow down. Like, almost pause before you say something. Well, that's genius. Pause before you say something. Wait and be late. And then he says, if you do that, right, if you listen quickly and pause before you speak, guess what? Anger is going to really be a lot easier to deal with, right? We talked about that in week one. Now, today in part two, I want to look at some more stuff that James writes, and he's really going to illustrate. He's going to bring to life, I think. I don't really need to do much commentary here. James is going to bring to light the power of words and the power of the tongue. And so let's see what he says. It's in James chapter 3. You'll see it here on the screen. You can follow along. James chapter 3, beginning in verse 2. And let's just kind of see what James, again, he's writing to the church, the brother of Jesus. He says this, all of us get tripped up in many ways. He's basically saying, hey, we all mess up. I wish this wasn't true. I wish I would have grown out of this, but it's true. I still struggle. He says this, suppose someone is never wrong in what they say. Like, you never mess up in what you say. Then they are perfect. They will be able to keep their whole body under control. And James is saying, he's illustrating the power of the words. He's saying, listen, if you can just gain control of your tongue, if you can gain control of your words, he says, man, everything else is easy. You'll keep yourself out of trouble. If you could just do this one thing, and look, he goes on to illustrate this. Some of you may know this. Verse 3, he says, we put a small piece of metal in the mouth of a horse to make it obey us, and we can control the whole animal with it. Any of you ever ridden a horse or been around somebody that's ridden a horse? Right? And I remember when I was younger, I was able to be around horses a little bit. And you know what the craziest thing when you watch somebody on a horse is when you see a kid, right? Like, you see a little kid, like one of my kids, they weigh like 30 pounds when they're wet, and they're up on a horse, which weighs about 2,000 pounds, right? But yet the 30-pound, the 40-pound kid, what can control the horse? Why? Right? Because there's the bridle, right? It's in the mouth, right? And he says, hey, if you control the mouth, what, you control the entire animal, right? That's what James is saying, right? He's saying little thing, right? The little thing in the mouth, big impact. He keeps going. He illustrates it again. All right, you get the horse, boom. Next, how about ships? Right? Remember, this first century when this is writing, and he said, hey, about ships. They knew about ships. He says, they're very big. Right? You think of an ancient type of ship. They're big. They're driven along by strong winds, but they are steered by a very small rudder. It makes them go where the captain wants them to go, right? You think of a ship, right, and the thing that steers it, like this little piece of wood, this rudder, and that one little piece of wood determines which direction the entire ship comes. He's saying, hey, small part, right? Rudder small, ship big, but the small part determines the direction of the entire ship. And this is where James is going, right? You kind of see what he's trying to say here. He's saying, hey, listen, your tongue, right? Proportionally to your body, the tongue is very small, but the tongue will determine the direction and the quality of your life. That's how powerful it is. It's going to determine the direction and the destination of your life. Okay, James keeps going. He says this, verse 5. He says, in the same way the tongue. Now think about your tongue for a minute. You probably don't spend a lot, unless you're a medical doctor. You don't think a lot about the tongue, do you? But think about the tongue. I mean, it's pretty ugly, right? I don't want to see it. Don't show it to me. I get that from my kids, right? They show it to me, right? It's ugly. It's small. It's only about 4 inches long on average, and it's mostly invisible, but yet it has the power to control your destiny. The tongue is made up of 8 muscles. Did you know this? This is interesting. The 8 muscles that make up your tongue, they never get tired. Like your other muscles, right? You work out or whatever, they're like, I can't even walk, my legs hurt, right? The tongue, the muscles in the tongue, they never wear out, they never get exhausted. Some of you should, you know that, right? No names. I'm not looking at anybody. But here's his point, right? This is what he's making a point. He's saying, listen, just like the bridle in the mouth of a horse, and just like the rudder on a big ship, the tongue has extraordinary influence and power. I mean, you know this, right? I mean, I'm not telling you anything. You're like, whoa, wow, Greg, you're so smart. Like, no, it's common sense. He says this. In the same way the tongue is a small part of a person's body, but it talks big. It talks big. It has the power to control the direction and the quality of your life. He keeps illustrating this. Go to the next verse. He says, think about how small a spark can set a big forest on fire, right? So think about this, right? You know one of these? Has anyone ever got one of these to light first time? You have? Nope. Ah, there it is, right? He's saying, hey, look, a small spark, right, can start one of these, right? One small spark can set an entire forest on fire. All it takes is one small spark, right? Think about it. A small spark can set a big forest on fire. I remember a few years ago, my wife and I were over at Marco Island celebrating our anniversary, and we were at a resort over there, and we walked outside, and there was just this smell, this burnt smell, right? And we went and sat by the pool, right? Here's this nice resort pool, and you're sitting by the pool, you know, with your book and just trying to chill out, and there's like ash falling on you. Right? We'll come to find out there's a forest fire in the Big Cypress National Preserve, miles away. But the way the wind's blowing, it's blowing it right over Marco Island, right? Big fire, enormous impact, affecting my vacation. And how did it start, right? Just a spark. Here's what he says, verse 6. The tongue is also a fire. Here he goes, man. He starts getting after it now. He says, the tongue is the most evil part of the body. That's strong, right? The most evil, a world of evil. James is saying that the tongue has the potential for endless evil. Every kind of evil can be initiated by the tongue. I mean, think about it. Murders have been initiated by words, right? Divorce has been initiated by words. Wars, right? If you study history, wars have been started by what? Words, the tongue, Verse 6, it makes the whole body impure. James is saying, your mouth can get your body in trouble. Like, think about this, right? If you're a parent and you put your child in timeout, you don't put their mouth in timeout, do you? What do? You put their whole body in timeout, right? If you're getting a divorce, you don't divorce a mouth. What do you divorce? You divorce a person, right? If the boss fires you, you're not fired because your mouth doesn't get fired, your whole body. If a principal expels you, you're not expelling a mouth, you're expelling an entire person. And James is being really practical here, and he's saying, it makes the whole body impure, and he would say it this way, as your words go, so goes your life. You want to know how your life is going to go? Look at your words, the things that you say, the things that you speak. As your words go, so goes your life. I mean, think about it. Where have words sent you? Some of you have been fired because of your words. Some of you, your life has been redirected because of your words. Some of you have been expelled because of your words. Some of you are estranged from your family. Why? Because of words. Some of you have lost friendships. Why? Words. Because of your words. As your words go, so goes your life. He continues. Verse 6, James says, it sets a person's whole way of life on fire, and the tongue itself is set on fire by hell. Now, this is some pretty strong language. Let me try to break this down. He says, hey, your tongue, it sets the whole person's way of life on fire. And what he's basically saying is, hey, you can, with your words, you can destroy your life. You can destroy your relationships. You can destroy your marriage. You can drive your kids away. You can destroy your career. You can destroy your future. That's how powerful your words are. I mean, have you ever scorched someone with your words? Have you ever scorched parents? Have you ever scorched your kids with your words? You know what we do? I do it, right? Is you try to defend yourself, right? Like you say something and then you try to defend yourself. And what do you say? You say something, you ever said something like this? Like, well, I'm just being honest. I'm just telling it like it is. I'm just telling it like it is. You know, I was just mad. I was just mad. Or I was just drunk. I mean, I didn't mean it. And James, if he were here, he would say, yeah, I hear you, but this is what it says. Hey, if you start a fire accidentally, you're still responsible for the fire that you started. Well, I didn't mean to. I mean, I was just, I'm sorry. If you start a fire accidentally, you're still responsible for the fire that you started, right? James is saying, hey, it makes the whole body impure. Words can corrupt the entire body. It sets the person's whole way of life on fire. And then he says this, a tongue itself is set on fire by hell. And what I believe he's saying here as I've studied this language is he's talking about this idea that the tongue is really, it can be, if used improperly, a real source of evil. Like from the tongue, like deep, dark evil can come from the tongue. Here's what he says. Let's keep going. Verse 7. He says, people have tamed all kinds of wild animals, birds and reptiles and sea creatures, and they still tame them, right? That humans, right, we've been able to subdue, to tame animals, wild animals, maybe not mosquitoes, but that's another story for another day, right? He says, verse 8, but no one can tame the tongue. He says, your tongue is untamable. He said, it must be guarded. You got to be always on guard. You always got to pay attention because the tongue, unlike these wild animals, the tongue needs to be guarded. That's why he says, hey, quick to listen, slow to speak. Quick to listen, slow to speak. He says this, he says the tongue, right? It's an evil thing that never rests. It's full of deadly, I mean, he's using like strong language here, right? I mean, it's evil thing, it's full of deadly poison. I mean, these are strong words. He's saying, hey, your tongue, it's volatile. It needs to come with like a warning label. You need to, like when you're born, have a sticker on there. It says, warning, this can destroy people. This can destroy relationships. And then he kind of closes this section out here. And I just, James just gets right in your face, okay? I'm just going to tell you what he's going to do. He's just going to get up in your grill, and he's just going to tell it like it is. And if it makes you feel bad, I'm sorry, because he's the brother of Jesus. He say whatever he wants. And so here's what he says. I just read it. I don't really need to commentate on it much. Verse 9. Again, he's talking to the church. He says, with our tongues, church, listen. With our tongues, we praise our Lord and Father. We praise Jesus.
And with our tongues, we curse people. And we do it even though people have been created to be like God. Even though these people are created in the image of God, even though I created these people, we'll come in here on a Sunday, right, and lift our hands and Holy Spirit, right? And then we'll leave here in 60 minutes and get out on US 1 and do what? Yeah. Whoa, oh, easy, James. Yeah, oh, heads up. Verse 10. Praise and cursing come out of the same mouth. He's calling you out. He's calling me out right here. My brothers and sisters, it shouldn't be this way. This isn't right. This isn't right. This is not the way of Jesus. This is not how you were created. It shouldn't be this way. Can fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? To which you would answer, no. Like, can you come in here on a Sunday and, oh, praise Jesus, right? And then leave and 2 hours later, yell at your spouse? It can't be this way. My brothers and sisters, verse 12. Can a fig tree, again, he's asking questions that he knows the answer, right? Can a fig tree produce olives? No, well, no. Can a grapevine produce figs? Of course not. And saltwater spring can't produce fresh water either. No, it can't. James is saying, guys, listen up. Take note. This is what I'm trying to tell you, right? This is what I'm trying to, as followers of Jesus, I'm trying to tell you that your words are so powerful. You are powerful because your words are so powerful, and you actually can destroy people. You can crush people. You can belittle people. You can fill people with doubts and fears because of your words. On the flip side, your words are so powerful, you can actually speak words of life. You can breathe words of life. You can throw courage to people. You can help people overcome obstacles and challenges they never thought they could because you can speak words of life. Guys, you got to know this. As your words go, so goes your life. It impacts your marriage. It impacts your kids. It impacts your coworkers. It impacts your friendships. Your words impact your life. And so what do we do? What do we do if our tongue's untamable? What do we do? James says, hey, you got to just be on guard, guys. I want you to be aware. I want you to be on guard. And I just wrote down just some real practical, there's more than this. I didn't have time to get into all of that. I just wrote down a few really practical things that I think you and I can do to be on guard against our words and our tongue. And we'll kind of roll through them kind of quick. But the first one is this, ask for wisdom. Ask for wisdom. You know, James says this in chapter 1. He says, hey, if you lack wisdom, you should ask for it. Right? If you lack for wisdom, you should ask for it and ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. And so we just need some wisdom, because there's a time when we need to speak up, right? There are times when we need to tell the truth and we need to be honest and we need to speak up in a grace-filled way. And then there are other times when you just need to shut up, right? And how do you know the difference? And how do you know when? And how do you know the timing? And how do you know? Well, wisdom. God, give me wisdom to know when to speak, when to say something, and when just to keep my mouth shut. If you're a husband, it's generally over here, about 90%, 98% of the time. Just keep your mouth shut, right? Keep your mouth shut. It's wisdom. No elbows anywhere. I see those. Right? Here's the second thing that I, just real practical. Surround yourself with wise people. Surround yourself with wise people. And here's the thing that I've just found that's so helpful in my life is I have a small group of people, my wife being one of them, where so many times when something will happen and I'm angry or I just want to say something, I'll hold my tongue in the moment and I'll go to one of these wise people, these handful of people, and I'll just go, this is how I feel and this is what I want to say. To which they generally reply, you can't say that. Do you want to keep your job? Can't say that, right? Like, this is what I want to say, right? But it's good just to kind of vent in a safe place. And generally, right, I have a few friends, including my wife, who will say, hey, here's like a better way to say that. You can say the same thing, but if you cool down a little bit, right, use the James, quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. All right, get that done. Now, you need to say something, but here's a better way you can say that. Right? You need people in your life. That when in the moment where you can hold your tongue in the moment, right? and don't say something that you regret. You can hold your tongue in the moment, and then you can go to people and say, this is what happened, this is how I feel, this is what I wanted to say, to which I hope they will go if they're wise. That's a key word, wise people, not any people, wise people. They will say, you can't say that. You can't say that like that. You need to say it like this. Surround yourself with wise people. Here's another one. This is one that some of you should write this down. Use fewer words. James were here, he'd probably just say, you know what, you could just solve this if you just shut up. Just quit talking. I mean, there's just too much, right? I mean, who invented all this stuff, right? If you go on to Twitter, if Twitter would disappear this afternoon, the world would just get better, right? I mean, it's just, really? I mean, we're in this culture where it's just people just, there's a culture of outrage, and so, yeah, that, exactly, Kiki, that's what I'm talking about, right? Right? We're in this culture of outrage, right, where people just, you're just saying stuff to be provocative, and it's destroying people, it's destroying our culture, it's just devastating. I weep thinking about the culture that my kids are growing up in. We need people just to shut up. We don't need your opinion. We don't need to know, right? Now, there's a positive side to this when we can use words, and we'll talk about that in a couple weeks. Here's number four. Stop complaining. No one's listening anywhere. Do you like being around complainers? I think I would rather have chalkboard, like fingernails on a chalkboard, before I would be around somebody complaining. I don't care. They don't care. No one cares. Yeah, you know what? You can always complain. It's always traffic. It's too hot. It's too cold. It's too this. It's too bright. It's too cloudy. It's too whatever. I get it, right? No one cares. And so just stop complaining. You know what? One of the things I'm so proud of our church is we're just not a complaining church. I've been around some churches where it's like it's something, right? Well, I don't like the color of the walls, and I don't know who did that, and music's this, and right? Right? I'm thankful for you, so I'm going to brag on you a minute. We're not a complaining church, and I don't think we're a complaining people, but the reality is just stop complaining. Number five, last, we're moving through this here. Encourage is the word. Here's something that I'm learning, and this has been really good for. This is changing the way that I'm doing life. Is when someone comes to my mind in random, I don't know about you, but random situations, you're driving, you're walking, you're in the middle of something else. Someone will come to your mind, a person, their name. I'm learning that whoever that is, to send them just a word of encouragement, whether that's a text, whether that's an email. Sometimes if I'm really feeling it, I'll whip out like a little card and just write like a 3 or 4 sentence little card and just go, hey, you came to mind today. I'm thinking about you. And just some kind of encouraging depending on what's going on in their life. You know what would happen if like hundreds of us just started like on a regular basis that every time somebody's name came up that we just started sending encouragement all around you? Because you don't know, right? You don't know what's going on the other end of that text or the other end of that email or the other end of that card. When somebody gets that and it breathes a little life into them. We'll talk more about this in a couple weeks. But what would happen if we just became people of encouragement? You know, James says, hey, the tongue can't be tamed, but by God's grace, it can be controlled, and it can be, by God's grace, used for a positive. And just imagine what would happen, right, in our marriages, in our homes, in our church, in our workplaces, if we began to understand and to offer words of life instead of words of destruction. You know, I spent, I work on these things for months, the last 4 months, but really in the last few weeks, these stories keep coming into mind. You know, like when you buy a car and you've never seen that car before, but as soon as you buy it, you drive around and you see, like, they're everywhere, right? It's like, oh, wow, everybody has the same car. I didn't know. Right? There's something that has, there's like a word for it, but there's something that happens, an awareness thing, right? And so that's why I think this month is important, talking about Big Fat Mouth, is because we're trying to create an awareness, right, an awareness for words. And so as I've been kind of doing this personally in my life over the last few months and getting prepared for these messages, I've been noticing things. And these stories keep coming back to me that I've experienced. A couple of stories just came back to me this week, and they were with me like every day, and I couldn't get over them. And one of the stories happened a few years ago. Every October, our church partners with the Coconut Grove Pumpkin Patch Festival, which is down here. I think this year it's in Peacock. It's been in Regatta Park. And we partner with them and we offer free face painting to the community. It's a great way for us just to be in the community and rubbing shoulders with people. And a couple years ago, we were doing it and I was down there at Regatta Park helping. I can't face paint, but I was down there doing something. And I left. I was just remember being really tired and I was walking up 27th, kind of Bayshore 27th. I was going up to Tiger Tail where my car was. And I was walking, and as I was walking, I heard behind me an adult male voice just start yelling and berating and cursing. Like, I mean, like the worst berating that I had ever heard in my life. And I flipped around, and I looked behind me, and about 15 steps behind me is this dad with his family, and there's this little, like, 3-4-year-old little girl. And he is just cursing at her and yelling at her. And it's like, I mean, my blood pressure is like going up. And I was going to do something about it, but he was really big. And I decided to keep walking. But there was this moment and my heart broke, right? And I thought, I don't know this people. I've never seen them again in my life. I may never see them again. But here was this girl, right? Her life, right? The way she views life, her perspective of life, right, is being shaped by these words that are being spoken to her. And I thought, oh man, I mean, that's just whatever you want to call it. It's life destroying, life belittling. It's just crushing, right? And then the other story I couldn't get out of my head was, and I don't know why this story was in my head, but, and I won't go deep into this, sorry, Whitney. 10 years ago, we lost our first baby. Our first baby died. About a day or so after delivery, the baby's dead. The hospital asked me, they say, what do you want to do with the body? And I don't know about you. I don't spend a lot of time. I never spent a moment in my life going, oh, yeah, I've got a human body. What should I do with this body? Right? Like, I've never. So I'm like, hey. I picked up the phone because I didn't know what to do, right? I mean, all this motion stuff's going on. I pick up the phone, and I call this guy named Sam. I'll never forget. This is over 10 years ago. I pick up the phone, I call this guy Sam, and I say, Sam, the hospital's asking me what to do with the body. I don't know. And this has impacted me so deeply, right? Here's this guy, and he just spoke words of life into me. He helped me process this. He listened. He took James's word. He didn't say a lot. He just listened as I cried, and I just say, here's what I'm feeling, what I'm, you know. And he took the time, I don't even remember how long the phone call was, it felt like a long time to me, and he helped me come up with a plan, a decision to what to do with this little human body. And I thought about this, I thought about the difference, right, between this dad on the street, between this guy named Sam, and I thought about, man, this is destroying, this is belittling, this is crushing, this is putting down, this is like offering life, this is offering hope. Even when it was kind of a really crappy situation, even when it was a terrible situation, here were words of life, words of hope, words of encouragement. And I thought, man, what would happen if a group like this, you know, a group of people in this great city, and I love this city, but it's the words said around here aren't the kindest in the world. Your work environment's probably, you probably don't like, hey, it's so good to see you, thank you, right? But what would happen if a group of us decided that we were going to be on the life-giving side? And that doesn't mean we don't tell the truth. It doesn't mean we're not honest. But what if we decided to be on the life-giving side of words? What if we took to heart what James is saying when he talks about the power of words and we were conscious of that? And again, we won't get it right every time. We're not perfect. We're not always do this right. But what if we erred to this side? What if we the majority of the time came to the life-giving encouragement side? Like, what would happen? Like, what would happen in our families, in our marriages, in our relationships? What would happen? I mean, I think we could begin to see something in the city and in the neighborhoods that would be completely other, completely different. I mean, environments that we're trying to create here on Sunday mornings where you come in, right? You come in from literally all over the world and all different kinds of experiences, but you come through that same door right there. And when you come in there, our prayer, our desire, what we plan and pray for is that this would be an environment, right, that would just breathe life into you, that would breathe hope into you, no matter what you're going through. We create these environments throughout the weeks. We call them neighborhood teams, and they meet in homes. They're getting ready to launch here in a couple of weeks, and they meet in homes, right? And mine, the one in my house, meets on like a Tuesday evening, and the reality is, man, you've been going through school, or you've been going through work, whatever is going on in your life. You can come into a home and sit around a table, and there's a group of people, right, that don't lie to you or say stuff, but they just breathe life into you. I mean, what would it look like to create those kind of environments? What would it look like to have a movement of people? A movement of people who took these words to heart, who embraced the teachings of James and said, man, what would happen if we began to live this way? My prayer for me, my prayer for you, my prayer for us is that we will heed the words of James and know that our words are powerful and untamable, but that we will be on guard and we'll say, through the grace of God, through the power of God, I want to be a life giver. I want to be a giver of life through my words. Can I just pray over you? God, thanks for your brother who took your words and continued your legacy. God, I look around this room and I am hopeful. I am encouraged. People tell me all the time, people in Miami are rude and people are this and that. And I'm like, yeah, I hear you. But you're not looking at the same people I'm looking at. God, I think we've got men and women and students in this room, God, who love you, who love your church, and who want to do great things. And so, God, I pray that you would just well up inside of us a hunger and a desire to use this power, to use this opportunity for good. And God, may we go out from this place and into our homes and into our friends and into places that we eat and hang out and work. God, may we go into there and may we speak words of life. May we speak words of hope. And God, I look around too. I think there are some men and women right now who could use some words of life in this room. And so I don't know how you want to do that, whether it's through someone in this room or maybe in this moment right now, you just want to speak or whisper something. And so God, I pray that if someone in this room right now just needs a word of life, a word of hope, that they would open their hearts and their minds to you. Because I sense your movement in that right now. So God, have your way among us. We thank you for that. And I pray this now in the name of Jesus.